have different types of kids, you can push different kids to a different envelope. And we all do it, we've all done it. You know, I won't say we experiment, but we try things. Sometimes it works, it's unbelievable, and sometimes it doesn't work. And that's where the next year we have to make that decision of, let's not do that. Yeah, does that answer your question?
Perfect.
Okay.
Mike, regarding the short sprint, starting block mechanics.
Yeah.
Because we run into situations too where, as a sprint coach, you know, of our team, and then we also have a hurdle coach.
Yes.
Let's just take the same kid. You know, is there a difference in terms of, I guess, emphasis on block work comparing to 110 highs to a 100-meter sprint? I mean, is there any difference in terms of how you're teaching the kid or looking at the kid? Because, you know, sometimes I don't want to, obviously, if the kid comes over or the hurdle coach sends, you know, somebody over, especially guys, you know, to improve their start out of the blocks.
Yeah.
I have a little bit of a caution, I guess, in a sense, just not knowing exactly whether our hurdle coach is teaching block mechanics differently from what I would be doing with our 100-meter kids. I mean, should there be a difference between the two? I mean, is all the start regarding getting to that first hurdle at a certain amount of time with a certain amount of steps without screwing them up, you know, changing their start, or is it?
Yeah, so, for what you're dealing with, same thing.
Okay.
Just keep it the same thing. The difference is, a hurdler, you're more aggressive, you really want to push, and don't push for longer than 4, maybe 5 steps until you start to transition into attacking the hurdle. Personally, my kids, we push through hurdle 3. Like, we teach, we stay in that mechanical position, but again, I deal with a little different type of kid.
Right.
I would not change anything. I mean, there is differences, like, if you get 7-step 100-meter hurdle men, their back legs are a little longer. If you are trying to learn different things, you push differently into the hurdle. You do. Like, I mean, there's a generic 4 to 5 step kind of thing for hurdlers. But I wouldn't touch that. It's not going to be a super beneficial thing.
Sure.
Unless you get the rare case where you get a physical specimen of a kid out of high school, you know, say someone that's 6'2" or 6'3" that can run 10.7 in the 100, he's a hurdler for you, then you might want to have a sit down talk with him and be like, hey, like, what do you say? What do I say? As long as you're on the same page, that's the best thing for the kid. The worst thing for the kid is when you're telling him one thing, the hurdle coach telling him something different, and then they lose faith in the system,
right,
because they don't,
right,
think you're communicating. So I would just try to have a talk with him or her and try to be on the same page.
I mean, when you're looking at the overall picture, obviously, you know, our hurdlers and sprinters, you know, do a lot of the same, you know, training,
yeah,
the exception of barriers. I mean, we should just be teaching them blocks from the get-go. Everybody has one group, and they do.
Yep.
Yeah, just go right. So.
Yeah, I mean, the biggest thing is to teach them how to overcome the inertia. If they can do that efficiently,
sure,
they'll be fine.
The biggest difference is the kids that come out of the blocks to the hurdles, when they can't even be aggressive to that first hurdle until they're confident. So they got to do a lot of block work to one hurdle before they can come out of it really aggressively attacking where you're trying to make them a better sprinter that first hurdle. So if they're fearful of that first hurdle,
sure,
you're wasting your time almost anyway. So that's critical. And I always like to put my sprinters and hurdlers in side-by-side lanes to push my hurdlers to go out as fast. We tell them you got five steps as your drive phase, and 6, 7, 8 is, for us 8-steppers, 6, 7, 8 is preparation to hurdle. And so that's kind of the mindset we have for our kids, where the sprinters, you're this drive phase, and, you know, you know, as long as you want, it degrades drive.
Anyone else? Any other questions? Sorry, kind of like I said, I went all over the place. Not really good sometimes without having, I guess, something in front of me. I have a lot of stuff with, like, drills and all that stuff. I know, like, everyone likes to see. If you text me, it's a lot easier. I'll respond quicker. I get so many emails, you know, daily that I have to get. Yeah.
So, like, in terms of equipment, And then we probably all have a bunch of banana dates or wickets, and they're like 6 inches. So
yep.
when you were talking about starting
like at 6 inches and moving upward.
At 12-inch barriers.
Yep.
So you mean 12 inches tall. What is the what are more creative ways to do that
yeah.
without
yeah.
buying 12, buying 18,
or
buying a bunch of
yep.
the bendable? Do you have
You can just take the hurdle, pop it off the gate, and set it there. So you know how most hurdles adjust.
Right, right.
You can take the gate off
right.
and set it there, like, and just and angle it to the height you want. I personally
okay.
like that a lot better than even, I have all these little tools of breakaways and stuff like that, because that teaches them to have a barrier in front of them that they can, there's a fear factor in hurdling that it's not going to break away. If you hit it, it's probably going to fall. It's not going to hurt them. But them to stay in a good mental mindset of, hey, I gotta attack this barrier. Or I know, I've seen, you've probably seen it too, you have a breakaway barrier, they'll attack that a little differently than when they have a normal barrier. But if you have like the visual look of a normal barrier, just kind of a little lower, however you want it, they typically attack it the same way.
You put that on the front side, or the back, whichever, far side
yep.
of the hurdle, when
yeah.
you set it down, you're not gonna set it in the front.
Yeah, no, yeah. And you can, another use a cheap thing, PVC piping. I've done that too. Yeah.
We can't bring our hurdles anywhere.
Yeah.
Outside.
And that's in PVC piping. You could buy just piping, cut it to what you want it. And like, I don't know, $100 will get you like.
Right, right.
100. You can get a lot of hurdles for $100 out of that. Yeah. Maybe not like 30 inches, but you don't need 30 inch barriers
right.
at that time.
Right.
Just like 22 or 24, however you want to do it. Yeah.
Some schools have taken junk hurdles they have left over and just cut them down so that they'll go down another couple of notches and they'll end up that way. We did that at the camp I was at. They did about a dozen of them. For our younger kids, we did
right.
down to
24
and 27.
Right.
Yep.
I like that.
So, yeah, that all that stuff kind of works.
Okay.
Any other questions or anything? Some design things? I do anything? Like I said, sorry if I confuse everyone. Might be easier when you see the stuff in front of you than you're running it.